Hey, what's up, everyone? It's episode 24 of the ASKJV Podcast. Today, I'm talking about dynamics on a kick drum, how to mix synths and pads within a dense mix, and the Mixcentric plugin and other mix bus plugins like that, and whether or not you should use them.
3, 2, 1. This is the ASKJV Show.
Here's our first question. I have a problem with the kick. The first hit of a sequence sounds too loud, but the next one sounds quite weak. Then again, a part of the song doesn't have any kick drum. The first is loud, in a mix with fast double kick sounding blurry. What am I doing wrong? It's something about the attack and release of the compressor?
Hey George, to be honest, this sounds like a performance issue a lot more than a compression or a mixing issue. It's probably just that the drummer is hitting the first kick really hard and the rest not hard enough, especially in double kick sections. They're probably just not playing it well enough. That said, maybe you do have some mixing things contributing to that. Like if you have a compressor that has a slow release, then maybe it's clamping down on the first kick hit and not opening up in time for the next hit to get through at full volume. So maybe you can try using faster release or just less compression in general. But this really sounds like a performance issue. So in this scenario for me, I would not try to fix those dynamics with EQ and compression really. If it was that bad, I would just replace or enhance with the sample using less dynamic range on the sample.
Neil asks, how do you mix synths and pads to fit in nicely in the background of a dense mix? They're always either inaudible or clashing with the main instruments for me.
So in the last episode, I talked a lot about mixing orchestral stuff and strings into heavy, dense mixes. Very similar approach for synths and pads. So again, it comes down to EQing in mono is a huge help for me. And that just really helps me identify frequency ranges that are maybe getting covered up or allowing me to find spots where stuff can poke through. So in the same way that I answered the question about strings with a synth lead or a synth pad, I'll flip it into mono and I'll start kind of sweeping around an EQ boost and try to find a frequency where the synth is popping out of the mix and allowing it to be heard. Similarly, I might try to filter out and dip out things, again, while I'm listening in mono with the rest of the mix, trying to find out if I make certain cuts, does it allow something else to cut through? So there you go. And again, automation, volume automation can be a big thing too. You can even get into advanced like EQ automation so that maybe when the synth kicks in, you bring it down some like 1K in the guitars to allow some mid-range for the synth. And then when the synth goes away again, you put that back in the guitar. So that's a little more advanced, but essentially it's just finding the frequencies. Even if it's something weird, like I said in the last episode with strings, maybe you have to boost 600 hertz on a synth pad to get it to cut through the mix. And, you know, while you would normally not boost that frequency range on many instruments, maybe that's where it really shines through in the mix. So make sure you're listening to the whole thing, not in solo, and just really try to find those frequencies where it really works.
Our last question comes from Jim. Could you review the new Waves Mixcentric plugin? For me, it's like I view adding a limiter to a mix is just for pseudo mastering, not something you would include if sending to a mastering engineer. So generally, I wouldn't use a plugin after a mix. But this one is intriguing. Would you recommend this one for enhancing a mix?
I have not used this plugin or tried it. I didn't really know much about it before this question. I just went and looked up some info about it. It does look kind of cool. Here's the thing. I mean, I don't really believe there are any rules. So you can't really say, you know, never use a plugin like this on your mix bus. If you know what you're doing and you like the sound of it, then by all means, use it. I would say that, though, don't be too heavy-handed and don't rely on a tool like this on your mix bus. I think if you're doing a ton of processing on your mix bus, it's usually a sign that something else isn't done right and you're kind of trying to put a band-aid on it. So, you know, if you're finding yourself tempted to find things for the mix bus that are going to really elevate your mix, maybe it's also a sign that you're not confident in your mixing and you're trying to look for a really quick fix that you can just put on the mix bus and it's going to instantly make everything sound better. I would look at tools like this as maybe you can get a little extra couple percent of sweetness or, you know, a little extra boost to your overall mix once you're, you know, 90% finish it, rather than thinking it's something that's really going to elevate your mixes. You really want to be able to craft a great mix without a whole bunch of stuff on the mix bus. So that's what I'd say. You know, definitely don't try to think of these things or get sucked into these things thinking that, you know, this one plugin is going to solve all your mix problems and it's going to give you that pro sound. Like, it's just not the case. Maybe it's going to give you another flavor to work with that you like. You know, if you try out the plugin and you like what it does, then by all means, use it. You know, there's stuff, you know, I use the SSL compressor and I use the Slate FGX plugin now on my mix bus with a little bit of limiting, not a whole lot before mastering, but a little bit. And I actually send that to the mastering engineer because I like the way that it does. I like to have a little bit of control over the loudness in the mix stage. Again, I leave headroom, but you know, I know that plugin now and I know kind of how it makes things sound, and I like to use that. So again, no rules, but don't be looking for something on your mix bus that's you think is going to fix everything. It's probably not going to happen. All right, thanks again as always for watching. If you need to have a question answered on the show, then make sure you go to askjvpod.com, fill out the form there. You can submit your question and we'll try to get it on the show. If you are watching this on YouTube, make sure you hit subscribe, or if you're on the podcast app, then just hit subscribe there. Leave a review, leave a comment. I love to hear from you guys. And lastly, if you're not on my email list already, make sure you go to hardcoremusicstudio.com. Jump on there. You'll get my free mixing cheat sheet and you'll get a ton of follow-up emails with lots of free videos, lots of free content. And then it's also through my email list that I provide opportunities to jump into my higher level training, my mixing course, editing course, and then future products that I'm coming out with very soon, including a new very intensive mixing course. So make sure you're on your email list, on my email list to get all those updates. And other than that, guys, thanks for watching as always. Keep asking questions and I'll talk to you on the next episode.